from the TechTV studios in San Francisco. It's the Screensavers!
And welcome to the Screensavers. I'm Steve Wozniak.
And I'm Kevin Mitnick. Thanks for joining us on the Screensavers, where we show you the coolest stuff and we answer tech's toughest questions.
And yes, we are co-hosting today. You're missing the normal. They took two of us to replace one, kind of. But fortunately, we do have Patrick here close at hand. In case.
To keep an eye on me or you, Steve?
In case. You know, to bail us out. And so this is new.
What?
We're the newcomers, but this is fun.
And Leo is checking in with us via satellite soon, isn't he?
Yes, he is. He's not quite here yet.
Okay. So Steve, we're co-hosting the Screensavers. This is the first time I've ever done a television show like this. Are you enjoying being here today? I mean, what do you think about that? I mean, this is awesome, isn't it?
No, I always wanted to do this. A once-in-a-lifetime time. I've been nervous as heck. Would I be ready for it or not? What are you up to these days, Kevin?
Well, I just finished writing this book, Art of Deception. It's a book on social engineering, and people can find it on Amazon. I finished writing the book. And Steve, you did the foreword for the book, remember?
Oh, I did.
Yes. So doing that, I'm starting up a new network security company, and that's pretty much it, and enjoying life.
And Kevin, you have a reputation as a hacker, and I really don't like certain kinds of hardcore hackers that really mess people's lives up. Please tell me you're not that kind.
No. My hacking heyday is behind me. I had fun. I didn't do it intentionally to harm anybody. It was exploring, circumventing security. For the fun of it. It wasn't really out to hurt anybody, but those days are behind me. I'm taking my background, my experience, my knowledge to help people these days, Steve.
I believe
you. Just like you're doing in your new company.
I believe you. Okay.
So what are you doing with your new company now, or what are you doing these days?
Well, I think Leo is checking via satellite now, so let's see little Leo here.
Leo.
Little Leo. Hey, Steve. Hey, Kevin.
Hey, how are you?
You're on a little screen here.
Watch the book plugs, okay, guys? Because that's my job.
We're just copying your style, Leo.
Yeah, I can tell. Hey, you know, I'm here in the Washington, D.C. area. We went and had crab earlier. What do you think? Good
wow.
luck for me?
Hey, what's that protest happening in Washington, D.C.? What have you done? Is this something related to you?
I didn't do it. It wasn't my fault. Actually, it's World Monetary Fund's meeting here, and there actually have been protesters on the streets. I feel like Peter Barnes. And there have been protesters on the streets, and actually they've been arresting people. They got about 600 arrests so far.
Well, I hope you're not one
you like
of them.
You like this view out here? That's the White House. You ever hacked the White House, Kevin?
No. I stayed away from whitehouse.org. Yeah.
I have some stories that I can't tell those.
Yeah, that's what I thought was.
I'll let you know. I'll tell someday on this show.
So what are you doing out there, Leo?
I'm going to be in Anne Arundel at Arundel Mills tomorrow, signing autographs with Patrick. He's going to fly out tonight in the Red Eye. And then I'm going to White Marsh at the Best Buy. I'm going to be there on Sunday also, signing autographs, meeting all the Screensavers fans. So if you're out in the Baltimore area, I hope you'll come by. You guys are going to do the show all by yourself. This is amazing. What do you got a good show planned?
We have an awesome show planned. We're going to have Tom Hanks on the show.
That's cool.
I'm going to go through a top five, my top five ways of keeping that could have kept me out of prison. Steve is going to be doing a product on a GPS tracking device, which I think is really going to be cool. And Waz is even going to be talking to the mafia later on the show.
I thought you gave up your life of crime, Mr. Mitnick.
I did. Now I'm on
no
a
more team. Of that
I
for
mean,
you,
this
sir.
Spot is feeling really comfortable, Leo. I'm really
you
enjoying
like it.
Even though this is my first time, it's feeling really good.
Don't get too comfortable, guy. But I gotta tell you, Waz, Mitnick, these are the keys to the show. I'm gonna let you take it out for a spin, but I want it back by 8:30, okay, guys?
All right. Well, thanks,
right.
Leo, for checking in.
See you later. Have a great time.
Hey, you have a great time, too.
Well,
thanks a lot. You know, we're giving away a computer, a Gateway 500 SE system. Isn't that ironic? So just watch and listen to the show carefully. We will have a question about something on today's show. Whoever can answer the question correctly will win a Gateway PC. So be sure to pay attention for your chance to win.
Actually, I have my own computers that I'm auctioning on eBay. These computers are older computers. They were 486. I have a 486-25, and I have a 486. I mean, look at that, Steve. This is old technology, and I have a 486-50. You know where these came from?
I think I had some like this.
This is what the these are the computers I used when I was a hacker, and the FBI recently returned these to me about a month ago, and I know you signed one of them, and I loved what you signed on here. What did you sign?
Huh, I don't remember this. You've got the whole world in your hands. Oh, that's what Steve Jobs and I used to put in our blue boxes.
Exactly. So it would be a great honor to me if you can sign my other laptop. And what I'm going to do is probably stick them on eBay pretty soon. It would be really cool. See if anybody would like some old laptops from the FBI.
Sign your laptop? Whoa. Yeah.
And I know I didn't have any Macs for you to sign, but maybe in the future, maybe I'll get a titanium one of these days.
This says something about you as a person, but I'm not going to say what. Here.
So, thank you very much for signing these laptops, Steve. I really appreciate it. It's really cool.
And those really came back from the feds.
The FBI. I don't understand this. I don't understand why they wiped the hard drives before giving me these computers back.
Okay, let's go to our online, let's go to our online poll question for you today. We know you're not the only ones. We're not the only ones who've been through technology for the last decade or so. So we're going to ask you a question to answer. You know, is the computer industry more exciting than it was 10 years ago? Yes, no. And you have 24 hours to vote. So go to www.thescreensavers.com. And let us know what you think.
What do you think, Woz? Do you think things have gotten better over the last 10 years?
Well, you know, I think there's different people have different answers in so many categories. Some things have gotten better, some things have gotten worse. It's like some kinds of freedoms that computers first gave us and the ability to do things on our own, create them on our own, have been taken away. And now we have to buy it pre-done and fit into other people's categories of how we live. So I think it's getting more like that on occasion. But look, we got digital cameras now, and we got DVDs we can burn, and we got the digital music so well, and the MP3s
what about the
and
internet?
The programs. And we got the internet, too.
I mean, remember the ARPANET?
Yeah, but
the internet
days.
Come on.
One could say the internet was such a beautiful dream at first. The ideas were so far and free, and everything was low cost and amazing what we were going to get. And the trouble is a lot of things have been blocked with everywhere you go. It's somebody selling something and spam, and I think there's more spam on the internet than email.
Well, that's a bummer. The spam. Unfortunately, I can't use the internet, so I haven't experienced it yet. Pretty soon, in 4 months. But I think the internet is an awesome tool because of the it could be used as a medium for communication.
How would you
AOL
know?
Instant Messenger.
How would you know?
Well, I actually did a talk radio show on the internet, and it was crazy because I had to have my friends, I burned them out, and producers, they'd go on the internet, I'd have to stand behind them and just say, and go here, go there, and I couldn't, you know, type on the
I'll
keyboard.
I'll tell you one thing. I do watch all the kids that grow up with computers, and they just have a whole computer life, and I think, God, I wish I could have grown up like that and had computers in my hand to use like they do today, but then I think, no, you know what, it's really nice to have also been able to see the before. As well as the during.
Yes, I know. Well, I think we talk more about this question later on in the show. So don't go anywhere. You don't want to miss our new product that was used to track Steve's whereabouts. And we'll show you that we'll show you that product later. Right after the break, Adrian Lamo talks to us about his hacking exploits. So stay tuned. Our next guest has been dubbed the helpful hacker for his habit of discovering security flaws in company websites and then telling them about it. But some companies haven't been so happy at having their security issues exposed. Joining me is Adrian Lamo to talk about why he likes to hack. So Adrian, I read a lot about you on securityfocus.com, and the first story that really surprised me was the story about you getting into Yahoo and changing a news story. Can you tell me a little bit about that?
Well, that was one of those things. I was sitting there with the opportunity to do that, and I just couldn't not take this opportunity. It's a once-in-a-lifetime situation to see whether or not people really, how much they pay attention to the news, whether or not if the news were to suddenly become Orwellian, reflecting things that could never hopefully actually happen, whether they would notice, whether they would care. The article I changed about AOL teaming up with the NSA to monitor citizens. things like that.
So how I understand this is you've been able to compromise security at WorldCom, Microsoft, Yahoo, the New York Times, and you've been able to break through their protection or their network infrastructures simply by using available tools on the internet, such as one I think is called Proxy Hunter, and you've been able to find vulnerabilities, and it would allow you to get access into their internal networks. I mean, was this easy for you to do, or was it, I mean, is this something simple or something that takes a lot of time and patience?
Well, it's less a matter of easy or hard than finding myself in the right place at the right time. I don't really set out with the idea of, okay, today I'm going to hack the New York Times. It works out more along the lines of, this is interesting. This is on the New York Times network. I'm going to follow up on this. This looks cool. And I find myself in places where they really don't expect outsiders to be.
Oh, and how did the New York Times react when they were hacked into? I saw the news story about it. How did they react to you? Like, I'm really surprised, because if I had done something like this, I certainly wouldn't be here hosting a television show. I'd probably be in custody. And I'm just really surprised that they have done nothing. Have they done some sort of investigation?
Well, they appear not to have been thrilled, and I don't blame them for this. Everyone has the right to their own reactions. They officially have no action that they have taken, but it's generally understood that there's been a complaint and an investigation initiated through the Department of Justice into the matter. They tried to subpoena MSNBC for information with regards to that. I don't know where it's going from there, but it's a risk that I knew was there from the outset.
So why are you taking these risks? I mean, what is your motivation behind, you know, I hear about these hacks into these companies, and you're kind enough to tell them about these security vulnerabilities, and then I read a news story about it, but what is your motivation? Like, why do you do it? Mine was more for the intellectual challenge and for the knowledge I gained. What is your motivation behind it?
It's a microcosm of the way I live my life. I try to see what's out there in every context that I'm in. In the real world, I'm just as likely to find myself, you know, in a, like, storm drain, steam tunnel, something like that, as I am in a company network. It's less, you know, wanting to one-up these companies and more just being interested in seeing what's out there. And once I find something that really demands attention, figuring that I might as well pass it on.
So what are you just stumbling across these? What are you saying? You're just stumbling across these open networks, and it's really, you have no particular goal. You just find them, and then you discover them, and then you publicize it. I mean, what's going on here? It's kind of weird to me.
I like to think that I find myself in the right place at the right time to do these things. I don't think that, you know, anyone necessarily has to think that it's good or right, or anyone has to be grateful or anything like that. But regardless of whether the companies involved are grateful, I still pass along the same information and still extend the same degree of cooperation. It's what I do. I try to learn about what's around me. I think that that's the way that the net evolves, by having people put pressure on the weak points, by having people learn about what's there and how it works.
So you don't really, do you have an agenda? I mean, other than just informing these companies that they have these security vulnerabilities? Is it that you want to get a job with them? Is it that you like the publicity? I mean, do you have any agenda per se, or is it just something you like to do?
Sure, playing my part in the evolution of internet culture, internet technology, and the universe at large. We all do it in varying ways, but I really think that all intrusions play a part. Everything that affects the internet plays a part in helping it evolve. It's all relevant. It's all brought us to where we are today. We can't necessarily second guess it.
Now, where are you doing these intrusions? Right now you're not living in a particular place. I understand it as you go from Kinko's to Kinko's, and you basically use their broadband to get onto the internet. Is that pretty much what you're doing nowadays, or do you, which I thought would think that is pretty scary, because I certainly wouldn't be caught dead in a Kinko's with all their cameras and everything watching everything I was doing. So it was kind of surprising when I read in one of Kevin Polson's stories that you pretty much roam around from Kinko's to Kinko's.
Kinko's is a big part of it. You know, there's varying degrees of exposure, but even from a purely pragmatic perspective, given the video quality and the average time that those videos are recycled, I'm not really concerned about the video part of it.
But now they know who you are. So I'm figuring that even if the videos are recycled, it's possibly, I just can't understand with the open 802.11 networks that you would, I figure that someone in your circumstances would be using open 802.11 networks rather than risking going into a Kinko's or something like that. And it was just kind of surprising. Really, the risks you were taking were surprising to me, and I was trying to figure out kind of in my own mind of like why you would go into public places unless, you know, even though they have a sign on every Kinko's, I think, what does it tap into our network? Like, I don't know if that's like an open invitation, but I was just like, you know, like wondering, like, you know, like it's, I'd be kind of nervous, but I've been through a lot, and I certainly hope that that you don't end up in my shoes, because, well, my shoes of the past, because it was a pretty unpleasant experience.
Well, there's a degree of danger, but life is, as always, gradations of risk. Everything that we do exposes us somehow.
But aren't you worried about getting busted?
I'm concerned about it, but I'd rather that if they do come for me, that they come for me when I've done everything that I've done out in the open, not having tried to run and hide, that they come to me and I was right there, you know, waiting, rather than that they corner me like, you know, some sort of environment out in the field.
So what are your plans for the future? Do you want to work in network security? I mean, where does Adrian Lamo want to be in 3 years, 5 years? What do you want to do with your life?
I try to avoid network security work, actually. Having worked in other fields that I was interested in and seeing how people that were passionate about things ended up burnt out and bitter about them after doing them 9 to 5 over a prolonged period of time, I don't want to turn cynical about something that I'm good at and enjoy doing. I get offered a lot of security contracts. I pretty routinely turn them down unless they're somehow exceptionally and uniquely interesting. I don't want to do network security by trade. I don't think that anyone that does network security by trade has standing to talk about network security. There's an inherent bias there.
How old are you?
21.
21. Well, I definitely appreciate you coming onto the show here. I mean, it's been an honor to have you here. And you have a website. Was it adrian.adrian.com or .org?
.org.
Okay.
Adrian.adrian.org.
So if anybody wants to contact you, they can send you an email there or go to your website and look for information how to contact you if they're interested.
Yeah, my website has my relevant contact information.
Okay. And visit thescreensavers.com for more information. I think there might be a link to your website on thescreensavers.com website. Well, stay put. Woz and I have a version of boot camp. And up next, while Woz was making his here to host the show, we were spying on him. Stick around to see how we did it and the results of our espionage after this web tip.
You can print just what you highlight by going to Print, then choosing Selection.
Okay, this morning, associates of the Screensavers secreted a tracking device inside of Woz's car. Well, actually, not really a tracking device, it's a GPS receiver. But what it did is log his every move in his vehicle. It's called Travel Eyes 2.
Look, they came over and plugged in the cigarette lighter adapter to it, and they plugged in this little antenna clipped on top of the car, and, you know, and they said, hey, we'll show you later what we did.
So basically, this box here contains basically a GPS, a little bit of hardware, there we go, and it actually tracked everywhere you went today.
Yeah, I guess.
A little frightening.
Well, you know, because I have trouble driving sometimes and can't find my way, and I guess I'm exposed. But I have this friend, Rick Doherty, and he puts it in his daughter's car secretly. And
so you
then,
can tell
oh,
that
yeah.
she was speeding.
Speeding.
How many times do I tell you don't go to North Beach on a Friday night? So we've got some software up here. What does this thing cost? Is it $400?
I think it's $300.
$300.
It's my recollection.
So we got Travelize 2 up here. We got
400.
Some software.
I'm corrected. It's $400.
So you started out in San Jose, and I guess looking from this, you drove all the way up 280 into downtown San Francisco.
It's a pretty simple route.
So we got something interesting. You said you put something special down here.
Well, I kind of have trouble finding my way around San Jose.
You made a lot of stops here. Is that what each of these numbers is?
Well, sort of. Now,
you know, I wish I could turn this 90 degrees because it almost looks like there's something in there. Turn your head to the left and join us here on the set. Did you write something in there?
Well, I think I accidentally drove in a pattern. The first one is a four-letter word that starts with F. F-R-E-E. Free.
Okay.
Free. But it was accidental. It was accidental.
And I suppose it was accidental to say K-E-V-I-N.
Free Kevin. We'll call it...
Wait a minute, okay.
Street riding. I heard about it. It's called street riding.
Okay.
It's the thing to do.
So GPS tracking device, you had no map. You couldn't see what this was going to see. So you basically plotted this out on a map and then drove the route and waited for it to show up when you saw it back in the studio.
It actually took a long time.
How long did it take to actually?
I was late getting here. It took over an hour.
Suddenly it's all coming together. So this would be easier on like a grid pattern in New York or something, maybe.
Yeah, well, no, I don't think so. No, it was tough to figure out where you'd come back and would it draw the lines in between?
Right.
And if we unplugged it from the cigarette lighter and plugged it back in, would it show those connecting segments, which it did, unfortunately?
That's pretty
makes
good.
It harder
so it
to
actually
read.
Managed to track you pretty well. So the point of this is the real world use outside of street riding. So people who want to track their kids, people who want to track their mileage, apparently a lot of salespeople use it to track where they've been and for the IRS so they can justify their 37 cents a mile or whatever people get.
Yeah, you know, for a small little personal unit like this, I'd probably more for people to track their own families where they're driving and, you know, well, for good reason.
No, true.
But, you know, it's actually lucky that we had a few friends of Kevin Mitnick on the show today because when we booted up the software, it was impossible to get, we had to guess a name and password that somebody had put in and we had no idea. Mm. And finally somebody hit on the right clue, but the right sequence, but it was really obscure.
Always memorize your passwords, ladies and gentlemen. Travel Eyes 2, around $300, available now. It can even track Woz. You can catch the full review on the screensavers.com, not to mention take a peek at the Woz's afternoon travel. Is it the Woz? Is that appropriate?
That's quite appropriate.
Okay.
That or anything, Steve.
This is a man who's creative. Free Kevin in a car through GPS. That's nice. Now don't go anywhere. Trust me, you do not want to miss Kevin and Steve's boot camp. Learn the newbie stuff, best tips, cool stuff from the experts, all that and more when the Screen Savers, a very special edition, rolls on.
Welcome back to the Screen Savers. I'm Kevin Mitnick.
And I'm Steve Wozniak.
Coming up this half hour, Adam Sessler will show us how to have fun with the mafia, plus the top five tactics that could have kept me out of prison.
But now we're going to do a little boot camp.
You're going to start off with your tip?
Okay. My first tip.
Now, is this on Windows or Mac?
I'm going to show it on a Mac today.
Okay.
The first thing I have is a little screen protector that keeps fingerprint oils from getting on my screen, which is very important to me. But I've learned that these things get covered with lint after a while, so I came up with my own little invention that I didn't read anywhere. I actually save the screen protector inside of its little Ziploc bag.
Clever. I like it.
Now, the tips I'm going to show today are a few Mac OS X shortcuts that are kind of nice and useful. Now, if I up and increase and decrease the volume, you can't hear it now, but it goes beep, 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 beep. But if you don't want it to make sounds, you can hold the shift key down and adjust the volume up and down keys, and it does it silently. That's one tip. Another one is sometimes you want to bring up the control panels, the system preference panels, we call it, that adjust your screen. You can take the brightness controls that normally increase and decrease the brightness of the screen and hold down the option key, click on a brightness up or brightness down key, and it brings up a panel, the preference panel, to set your screen resolutions and that sort of stuff. That's another tip. Or you can hold down the option key and hit the volume up or volume down buttons, and it opens the corresponding sound control panel. Okay, the last tip I have to show. If you want to cycle, if you have a bunch of windows open on your screen, and you want to sort of cycle through them, Command Backtick. It's on the tilde button. Command Backtick. And it cycles window, window, window. That's the end of my tip.
Wow.
That's my tips for today.
I'm going to have to get a Macintosh or an Apple or a titanium.
Okay. Kevin, how many tips do you have?
Well, now it's my turn, and I have a trip on a product called Trillion. Now, Trillion was covered on the last show, in yesterday's show, and Trillion is an IM client. But what the problem is a lot of people don't realize that when they're at work and they're using Instant Messenger, their system administrator or even somebody else that's on that same network could actually eavesdrop on those communications. It's pretty scary. So imagine a lot of people at work. Now, I know a lot of people at TechTV here. I go by their cubicles, and they're on Instant Messenger all day. So all it takes is one person to go download AimSniff off of, you know, they could find it in Google. And what they can do is if there's somebody that's kind of sneaky could actually intercept all those instant messages. So what do you do?
But I always thought, why don't you just put a TV camera over them? You'll see every key they type.
Well, yeah, that's true, but that's a little bit obvious. So what I'm going to, what my Windows tip today.
The feds, they said you're not allowed to go on the internet, right?
Right, no internet.
Oh, hold on.
Okay, all right. Oh, you're going to pull the Ethernet cable out. Oh, thank you, Pat. Thank
not
you.
Not connected.
Not connected.
Don't come after
I'm
me.
Safe. No internet. So let me switch it over to Windows XP here. Now, here's a trillion icon. Of course, you double-click it when it's, and I'm not going to open up a new copy. And what will happen is it will come down in your system tray. And this is the symbol for a trillion. You click it, and this is the trillion box comes up. And to get to preferences, you click kind of here on the globe. And then you'll see preferences will be an option that comes up. You click on preferences, and you'll see a lot of preferences will come up. Now, for secure messaging, what Trillion calls secure IM, which uses encryption, so if somebody was sniffing the network, the only thing they would see is gibberish. You can do this, you can set Trillion up only when the other person you're communicating is also using Trillion. So this only works when both people that are communicating or a group of people are using the Trillion client. And how you configure it is you simply go under chatting services, and there's a miscellaneous link. Click on the miscellaneous link, and they have normally what's here is you'll have two boxes which are not checked. You simply check activate secure IM capabilities, and you also can check when possible make the best efforts to maintain a secure connection. You click apply, and what normally happens when you click apply, which for some reason it's not working here, is it will actually disconnect that session and it'll have you reconnect so it can create a secure session. And what will happen is on both windows that come up when you want to send messages, it will have like a little keypad lock, like in Internet Explorer or on Netscape. So that's pretty much my Windows tip today. So coming up next, Megan shows off the newest release from Google. And we'll play a little game with the Mafia when Screensavers continues.
The host of Extended Play now joins me to tell us about a game I'm dying to play and see. Welcome, Adam.
Yes, I'm glad to be here. Now, this is Mafia, which obviously is why one would be dying to play it, because you die a lot in this game, while you also kill other people, too. Now, this is Mafia, and this has become one of the biggest surprises of the year. I wasn't expecting much from this, but it's one of the best PC games, and of course, you play someone who's in the Mafia as you move up through one of the crime families in a fictitious city, and it's really all about gunfights. And we're going to see some right here. There's a bad guy, we can see. And it's very similar to both an action game, say like Max Payne, which is one of the biggest action games of last year, and Grand Theft Auto 3, which was one of the biggest games last year and almost of any year. There's also a lot of driving you have to do as you go on various missions. Sometimes you have to protect a young woman from some local thugs in the neighborhood. In this mission right here, I've gone to the airport to hunt down a member of the family who has betrayed us and is about to sell all our tax information to the feds, and I've got to stop him, as I'm doing right here. It's a fun game, it's beautiful to look at, and it's a lot more intelligent than a lot of other games in this genre, as you have to really think about it. It's trying to be true to the era. Here we go. It's hard to talk and play at the same time. Isn't that terrible? Anyhow, so this should give you a good taste of the game, and I'm trying to think of like other just great elements of it. It's hard to play, but nonetheless, it really comes across as a strong title.
Okay, what's something difficult about the game?
Yes, now I'm glad you brought this up, because there's one big problem in the game, and we're going to see some video of it right now. Early on in the game, you have to steal a race car, and after you steal this race car, you then have to drive this race car in a race. And yeah, we can see it right here on the video screen. While it sounds benign, it's absolutely impossible. You know, when you buy a game called Mafia, you're buying it thinking that you can hoist a Tommy gun and shoot at people. You don't think that you're going to be playing Gran Turismo, which all of a sudden you find yourself doing. And this is happening, and it's nearly impossible, and it comes very early on in the game, which is a pity because for most average gamers, you won't be able to get through it, and all the good stuff is right after that. Now, luckily, there's a cheat out there so you can skip the race.
Well, who's this game best suited for?
Well, I think this game is best suited for, A, it's suited for adults, as you can see there. It tends on the violent side. It's suited for anyone who likes a good action game, but might also be tired of action games that tend to be a little bit too heavy on the machismo side and just sort of mindless shooting. This has a little bit more thought, both in its story and in the way that you're having to really consider how to, you know, take care of the bad guys and dispatch them. It's more sophisticated than other stuff in the same genre.
Okay, thanks. Are the keyboard controls difficult, I wonder?
No, it's actually, you control them very similar to you would in a first-person shooter.
I'm one of those guys that doesn't play much in keyboard games. My kids have...
Now, I don't know if you've ever played Quake or Unreal Tournament, but you use the typical WASD, so you have sort of digital, and then you move the camera around with the mouse. It works very well that way, which is atypical for third-person,
yeah,
third-perspective
I have played
games.
Them, and as much as I play them, I can never do as well as my kids.
Yeah, actually, I have to even say myself, there are some 10-year-olds out there that shame me frequently.
Well, thanks a lot, Adam, and all you out there, be sure to watch Extended Play tonight at 9 p.m. for the best in gaming. Okay, for links to Extended Play shows and game reviews, go to our show notes at thescreensavers.com. Okay, Megan, let's check with you for the site of the night.
Thank you, Waz. I think you're doing a great job. It is great to have you guys here. It's fun. So today is Google's fourth birthday. Hooray! And isn't it just like Google to give us a present for their birthday? I'm talking about Google's new news service, and I'm going to go out on a limb here. Prepare. I like it better than /dot. Google's had news.google.com in beta for a while, but the newest release is pretty amazing. Let's take a look at this. They've got a new look with some images sometimes. This is the science and tech section. They have top stories, of course, with all kinds of news. World, U.S., business, science and tech is my favorite, of course. And they have what I like the best. They actually do call stories from /dot, which is cool. They list here like when it was posted. 2 hours ago, 1 hour ago, 55 minutes ago, which is pretty interesting. So you can actually stay pretty much up to date. And what I also like about this is it lists the different sources where the story comes from. A lot of times when, you know, you look at something, on the web especially, stories can, you know, be generated in a lot of different places and actually be false, which is no good. What I also like is the search function. So if I want to search for news about Palm, say I just enter Palm and hit Google search or enter, and it's going to find just news about Palm and really updated news as well. Of course, as everything that Google does, they use their tried and true algorithm Voodoo, which tries I might have been never been able to figure out exactly how it works. All I know is it works, and it's smarter than I am. And as I said, I like it better than /dot. It calls from over 4,000 sources, but considering that /dot is a community-driven website, you're actually going to get a lot more than 4,000 sources there. And Google News doesn't have the message board posting features, so you can't be giving your opinions on the stories. But for my purposes, when I'm collecting the news for screensavers, it's still pretty great. So you can get the link to this site of the night as well as other sites we featured all in the last year. Every site, that's all thescreensavers.com. And we are just getting started. Coming up, Kevin has a top 5 list of the ways he could probably have stayed out of jail. I'm kind of scared about this. Plus, I teach you how to spell well on the web after this Windows tip.
Go to Folder Options, then File Type. Select a type and choose Edit, then Change Icon to select from a gallery of new icons.
We all know and love Martin's top 5 list, but in his absence, I decided to do one of my own today. And looking back at my hacking past and knowing what I know now, here are their top 5 things that could have kept Kevin free, and there would have been no need for the Free Kevin movement. The first, number 5, I should have climbed out the second story window in Raleigh when the FBI knocked on my door at 1:30 in the morning. Number 4, I should have avoided wearing hacker t-shirts like this one when working from university computer labs or Kinko's copiers. Not a good thing, bad sign. Number 3, I shouldn't have abused the Kevin Mitnick cellular phone plan. Back then, cell phone calls were $1 a minute. And when I used to stay on the computer, say, 8, 10, 12, 14 hours a day, that aroused a little bit of suspicion with the cellular phone companies. Number two, I should not have learned to whistle nuclear launch codes from prison payphones. For some reason, federal judges get scared of people that could whistle launch codes. I just don't understand it. And finally, number one, I should have met Darcy earlier in life, because that's one girl that knows how not to get caught. That's my top five list, but I think Martin better look for a new gig. Now for the lovely Megan, will you give us the download of the day?
I will, thank you. Those are good tips for everyone to avoid prison. And I'm glad you just revealed Darcy's darker side to the world. Hope she forgives you. So I have never been a good speller. I'm gonna admit that right now. And ever since I've become hopelessly addicted to my spell checker, it's gotten worse every day. So I wanted to thank Sydney Chong for creating a program that's called IE Spell. It lets me check my spelling wherever I write, in webmail, in my blog, in my web publishing program, even in online forms, because you never know when you're going to make a spelling mistake. Let's take a look at this. IE Spell lets you check in three ways. The first way is this big old button here next to the, at the top right-hand corner next to the little Windows icon. So I can I'm right in here on the web, and I just click IE Spell, and it will bring up a little window and see the first thing. I'm writing about Woz and Kevin's appearance tonight, and the first word it doesn't understand is Woz. So, basic spelling, spell checker, it's got everything. You can add it, because, I'm going to be writing about Woz a lot. Also, you can select a word and right-click it, and then you've got your IE spelling options in there. And the third way is from the tools menu. You know where the tools menu is. You just click and it's just a little add-on, so it'll be, the IE spell option will be there. It's really accurate and really fast. I found it a lot faster than some of the spell checking programs that are already built into webmail and stuff, so I like it. The only drawback of this program is it's for Windows only and only for Internet Explorer. So if you Mac users have a similar program in Mac OS X, send it to me and I'll get it on there. For now, you can get the link to this program at thescreensavers.com. Back to you, Kevin.
Stay where you are. Coming up on this very show, Morgan has a trick to ease your adjustment into Windows XP. Plus, we are giving away a gateway computer and Martin's chat with actor Tom Hanks and all that and more as the Screensavers rolls on. Welcome back to The Screensavers. I'm Kevin Mitnick.
And I'm Steve Wozniak. Thanks for joining us. Your eyes are not deceiving you tonight. Kevin and I, we're hosting tonight under Pat's watchful eye. He's our safety net. He lost his voice.
Oh, man. Folks, if you want to get a hold, I'm like in safety net mode here. If you want to get a hold of, well, of you two, I had a question. You guys got websites, email addresses. How can people track you two down after the show? Kevin?
Well, they can track. Actually, I do have a website, woz.org, because I'm kind of an org type person, but okay. I have a company going now, and woz.com kind of gets
so
to the company.
Woz.org or woz.com.
Yeah, I was lucky to get some three-letter domains.
Back in the day you were.
Back in the days.
How about you, Kevin?
Well, my website is www.freekevin.com. Go figure. And then I have a new company website, which is www.defensivethinking.com. So those are the two websites that are related to me. Besides all the other ones out there that talk about me.
Those are the ones that, those are your websites. Those aren't other people's websites.
Correct.
All right.
Correct.
Good
coming up in this half hour, find out what tech gadget Tom Hanks can't live without. And I hope you've been paying attention to the show, because we are going to give away a gateway computer. So let's check in with the fine folks at Tech Live to see what's coming up tonight. News anchor Michaela Pereira joins us from the Tech Live set What is coming up?
We have a great show. I was just going to say, I think Patrick does a very good executive producer thing offset there. That's very cool. I think I might kind of, maybe he can come over here and help. You're doing a great job. You're like the guy on Regis and Kelly. Get him off the set. We are going to give you a quick peek at what's coming up on Tech Live, which is right, of course, after the screensavers. Overheating is more than mere inconvenience for athletes out on the field. We all know too well that it can, in fact, be fatal. But the answer to helping overheating football players keep their cool could lie right in the palm of their hands. Coming up on Tech Live, we're going to show you the device that some football teams are using to make sure their players don't get too hot under the collar, and we mean literally. Also, these, you're going to see them in a second, those ones, those stoic faces, they're cracking up. Mount Rushmore, one of the nation's more prominent national landmarks, chock full of crevices, and we're talking more than just wrinkles on old Abe's face. Coming up on our show, I'm going to tell you how researchers are finding these cracks and doing a little lifting and tucking. No, they're going to fill them in. We'll tell you all about that on the show tonight. Our show, of course, is right after the screensavers, 5:30 Pacific, 8:30 Eastern. Gentlemen.
Yeah, thank you. Earlier in the show, we introduced our poll question and of the night, and we're asking you, is the computer industry more interesting now than it was 10 years ago? Whatever that phrase means to you. You know, well, what do you think?
Well, you know, it's kind of a problem. It's a problem to answer that question. You know why? Because for 5 years, I wasn't even able to use technology. But from what the computer industry was back in the early 90s, from what I've known before into now, I think it's awesome. I think that there's been a lot of advances. I think the internet is really cool, and I really want to get on there, and I'm going to have to wait 4 whole months to do it. And I don't know. The computer industry, I think, is advanced. You know, look at the speed of processors. Look at the cool gadgets that are out there. Look at that camera you have in your pocket. I mean, I just think it's cool. I love it. I mean, what do you think about the computer industry? Yeah, I love that camera.
Yeah, it's fast, too.
Yeah.
Changed my life. I really do think we probably have... things are better today, but interesting is a thing, like, you get used to it. You kind of get used to it, and you expect this, and you expect that, and now it's sort of like a job, and you have to do it. And boy, when I was teaching kids computers, and it was, like, so rare to even have a computer, the word computer was magic, there was something that inspired them to want to learn more than now. You say, you get a computer class, and it's like, so what? It's an everyday thing now.
Yeah, I guess the excitement is grown. Not really grown, but I guess it's dissipated in a sense because, you know, it's taken for granted.
Yeah, and then also, you know, and back when, it was like you got a computer and you got a programming language and that was about all you had. You almost had to create your own world. And that's really motivational because it's under your own control how it's going to work out in the end. You don't have to remember this particular menu has this particular menu item and it works this particular way when it works. So,
cool.
You blame yourself, and you were autonomous and all that stuff.
So. I guess our online poll question for today is the computer industry more exciting than it was 10 years ago? And you have to answer yes or no. You have 24 hours to go vote, so go to www.thescreensavers.com and express yourself. Now let's take a call from Morgan. Morgan joins us on the phone from Phoenix, Arizona. Thanks for joining us, Morgan.
Sure. Is that Morgan? Hi, Roz. Hi, Kevin.
Hi, how are you?
Got a question
pretty
for
good,
us?
Pretty good, yes. Kevin, I've been a fan of yours since 95 when this book came out and 96 when this book came out. And I was wondering, out of all the books that have been written about you, which one is the most accurate?
Well, I would say The Fugitive Game is more accurate than any of the other books about me, but I can say the most accurate book will be the Kevin Mitnick book when I can publish that book, and I think it's going to be about 7 years from now because I had to sign a certain agreement with the U.S. government during my plea negotiations that I can't publish a book about my stories until a certain amount of time passes.
You know, Kevin, the person you were interviewing said something about, you know, if you do something openly, and if you take credit for what you do, you're not going to do anything so bad it really hurts people badly. But it's weird because here's a case where the government's the one trying to hide what's the truth, what's really happening.
Yeah, and my hands are tied, unfortunately. If I didn't sign that agreement, I probably wouldn't be here co-hosting a show with you and Pat. I'd probably be raking some leaves on some, you know,
you think the government would want that information out because it would help prove that they were right about you and...
I don't think so. I think, rather than getting into the specifics of the story, The Fugitive Game is a more accurate story, but none of them are completely accurate. And thanks for the call, Morgan.
Okay, thank you.
Hey, you're welcome. Now let's get a Windows tip from Morgan.
I thought they'd never ask. They're doing pretty well, aren't they? Remember my first appearance on the Screensavers? Here, I'll do an impression. I did Sight of the Night, I think. I'm trying to remember what I did. I think I did the Google paper, Anatomy of a Large-Scale Hypertextual Search Engine. I think that was my first Sight of the Night. A rather ambitious undertaking, but hey, I'm an ambitious young woman. All right. So for the Windows tip for today, you know the good old days, if you left your folders open when you turned your computer off? This was in Windows 95, 98, and ME. You left your folders open for maybe your desktop or my computer or whatever you happen to be working on. You would turn your computer on and those folders would be open. You could sort of pick up right where you left off. XP, you can't do that. And it's really, really sad. Until I came and showed you how to turn that feature back on in Windows XP. I know you're all sitting there saying, whew, glad Morgan's here. All right, so you just open up any folder, my computer, my documents, whatever you happen to have open. You can do it right now, follow along with me. Okay, so it's real easy, you just go to Tools, and then Folder Options. You probably see where I'm going with this, don't you? And then it's not on the first tab, they hide it on the second tab, and then you have to go, oh, the way down to the bottom, and it is restore previous folder windows at log on, a quite verbose way to say it, but I don't really know how I would say it any better, so I guess I got to give them a little respect for that. We just check it, okay, and then we hit apply. I guess we could just hit okay, that would have the same effect, and now it's good. When I restart my computer, I'm going to have this folder on my desktop waiting for me, reminding me to say, I don't know, do my homework or finish that paper that I was trying to put off, like I always do. My editors hate me, I'm always late. All right, so I've come to the rescue once again. Rejoice, rejoice, rejoice. Go to thescreensavers.com for my article, and I've also included, for your pleasure, a charming little tiny picture of me engrossed in the computer screen. It's a beauty, although I think I was looking at something blue, so I do look a little bit pale or something like that, but it's all right. What are you gonna do? All right, back to you guys.
Up next, thanks Morgan. Up next, find out what Tom Hanks thinks is fascinating about space when the Screensavers continues.
Gentlemen, it's been a privilege flying with you.
Welcome back. Martin recently sat down with actor, producer, and director Tom Hanks at the Apollo 13 IMAX premiere to find out exactly what fascinates Tom about the space program. Let's take a look.
9, 8, 7, 6. Ignition sequence start. 3, 2, 1. Ignition.
Tom Hanks?
Yes.
Let's chat. You remark in the film that it's a technological marvel that a computer can fit into one room.
I mean, you hold millions of bits of information.
I mean, how amazing was that, that they actually controlled spaceships and got people to the moon with such primitive technology?
I think it's astounding. I think it's absolutely astounding that, you know, slow-moving things. The computer on board, both the command module and lunar module, is not as powerful as a calculator you'll get. It couldn't even add. Didn't have the functions in order to add up numbers. They still had to do that with pencils and slide rules. I think it's just a testament to, you know, what people can do with whatever tools they have at their disposal.
And precisely, right now we have really powerful computers that can fit into the palm of our hands. Have you taken part in the computer revolution over the past 10 years?
Not really. I still use it pretty much as a glorified typewriter and a way to print pictures. I mean, I have a bunch of stuff, but I, you know, even like date books and calendars, I still just go and write it down on a piece, write it down on a piece of paper.
So when you're researching the space program, World War II, any of your interests, whether or not it's for a film, do you go to the internet?
Somebody does, yeah. Somebody does for me. So go out and find something like this.
You have guys. You have web surfing guys.
We have the research department, and you know what? More often than not, they come back in a half an hour with what it is you were looking for.
Beyond computers, any tech gadgets that you use in your life that you really couldn't live without?
The most amazing thing is, I think, the BlackBerry, Rim's BlackBerry. That to me is that surpasses every other one of those types of. What is it, PDAs, whatever it is.
Sure.
The fact that you can get real-time email messages that can be long, that aren't just like 100 characters, and then it holds the entire Rolodex and whatnot, I think that's the one thing that I've had that said, wow, this really makes my life easier.
We have liftoff.
Check out our website, thescreensavers.com, to find out if Tom Hanks is going to be a space traveler one day. Now let's take a call. Do we have a call? Hey, Stephanie joins us on the phone from Ontario, Canada. Thank you for joining us, Stephanie.
Hi.
Do you have a question for us?
Yes, I've got a question for Woz. I've been watching those groovy Apple Switch ads. So I was wondering how hard it actually is to switch from PC to Mac.
Well, technically, and how you have to learn how to use the mouse and the programs and all that, pretty much the programs are what you run, and they're pretty much, it's so similar, and the two systems are so similar now, it's really not hard to switch. It's actually not hard to switch either direction. I mean, Kevin, you could buy a Mac and say, I want to be individual. I want to have a little pricier machine, but you get what you pay for, you know? And you could, and I want something special that's a little more special in the world than just every other machine that's sort of the same.
Yeah, well.
You could do it. And you know what? You could do it the night you pick it up. The only trouble is you turn it on and you'd wind up doing everything you can think of with digital photography and digital music and burning DVDs and everything so much easier than you've ever seen before in your life. That's what it's all about for us.
What about the mouse?
What about the mouse? Well, if you got to buy a laptop, you got a trackpad. And the mouse is great.
Well, you have a titanium, so, I mean, you know, do you use Windows much yourself?
I use Windows very seldom. I actually used it a little yesterday, but it's virtual PC program.
But now you're becoming a Unix user, because with OS X, it's really a free BSD kernel.
Have you ever used a Mac?
Years ago, I used a Macintosh.
Okay.
Years ago.
Don't forget, there was a time when the Mac was what we see now in computers. Every computer today is a Mac, really. And because there was a time when PCs were something totally different with all this gooky tech stuff and...
Yeah, exactly. How long have you been using a Mac, Stephanie?
A Mac? For a couple years, 2 years or so.
Well, I mean, what do you think of it? I mean, have you used both platforms, PC and the Mac platform. I mean, what's your opinion?
I'm liking the Mac.
Well, that's glad to hear it. Sounds right. I mean,
well, here's the creator, right here,
quite.
Right in front.
Not exactly, but yes.
Let's take another call. Thank you, Stephanie. Scott joins us from Mount Iron, Minnesota. Thank you for joining us, Scott. Do you have a question for us today?
Hey, Steve. Hey, Woz. I had a question. I have an iBook laptop, and I was wondering, the battery life. I get about 2 hours, and Apple says 5 hours, and I was wondering, how can I maximize my battery life so I can get more battery?
Well, it depends kind of partly on what operating system you have on for some of the answers.
Oh, it's Jaguar.
What?
It's Jaguar.
Yeah. Oh, Jaguar. Yeah. Mac OS 10.2, the new Jaguar. First of all, turn the brightness down. That's the main single thing you can do. Take out any plug-in cards that you're not using, any plug-in accessories that might be drawing power. Turn off the airport, the Wi-Fi system, if you're not using that. Turn off any networking facilities that you can find that you aren't using. And don't have a lot of apps running. And generally, you can get about a 2-to-1 range in maximum battery time to minimum on all our computers now.
Oh, okay, thanks.
Good luck. Okay.
Megan, anything new on the Screensavers website?
Why, yes, there is. I asked earlier about anyone who knew of a spell checker you could use on the web in OS X, and I got a lot of emails. Sam sent in an email saying that OmniWeb, which is a very cool browser for OS X. I don't know, do you use this, Woz? Do you use OmniWeb?
Yeah.
Very cool browser. You like it?
I do.
I like it too, and it actually has built-in spell checker, so if you haven't checked it out, that out, you can. And then someone else told me that there's actually a built-in spell checker in OS 10 that'll work in any program. I don't know. Do you know if that's true?
I can't give you a firm answer right
now. Yeah, I can't either.
It's supposed to be true, and it's what we do is we implement them as services, and any program that's written in the Cocoa language,
right? Yeah,
Cocoa,
that's what
system
they said. Yeah.
Can run the services. Yeah.
Yeah. So there's a lot of options out there. We're not surprised with OS 10. Also, I wanted to tell you, if you wanted any of this information, it's all going to be in our newsletter, and I'll show you how to get that if we can take a look at my screen real quick. It's very easy, and you're going to really enjoy. There also, we've been adding little personal notes to every newsletter that you won't see in the show. So everything you see in the show and more. So we're scrolling down the screensavers website, scrolling, and then all you have to do is click on subscribe. And you're going to have to become a member, which is very easy and free, of course. You just enter your email address. And you can choose from all of these newsletters. And the screensavers today is, wait, I don't know why we're here in the little corner down here. You just check and then enter your email address and hit OK. It's very easy. So check it out at thescreensavers.com. Back to you, Woz. And by the way, you two are doing a great job. Keep it up.
Okay, everybody, stay where you are. Our gateway giveaway is coming up. It's too bad Leo isn't here to see this. We'll be right back.
Sometimes I don't read as well as I should. Welcome back, folks. It's time to find out who's been listening closely. So don't you go anywhere so they can win we're doing this together, all of us. The last
gateway. Well, I saw the name Patrick up there, so I was a little bit confused.
I'm thinking I'm always over there, and Steve's like, come on. Anyhow, who's going to win a Gateway 500 SE computer? Marvin joins us on the phone from, I hope to say this right, Soledad, California. Did I get that right, Marvin?
Yes, you sure did.
Excellent. So I understand you have a question you want to ask us first.
Well, yeah. Okay. I wish Leo was there.
You know what?
Can somebody 56 years
you're
old
trying
just
to win a computer?
Out.
You diss me, Woz, and Kevin? Kevin, who's not going to have the FBI watching his every move in months?
Well, the reason I say that is I think he's closer to the question. And that is, can somebody 56 years old learn how to run one of these things?
Yes!
I don't know. Depends. Depends on the brand. You know what? You actually can, but it takes a lot of time. Unfortunately, some of us don't have a lot of time, and you really need some good instruction. And one of the problems is you can learn a computer 1 year, and 2 years later, they're all different. So you have to relearn it. That's where the kids have a big advantage over us.
I know that.
What kind of stuff do you want to do, Marvin?
As far as learning it?
Yeah.
I guess, making pictures and digital photography and maybe even the DVD or, how you put them onto a disc.
I'll tell you what. Either way, you're at a great time because it's never been easier to work with digital photography on a computer, Mac or PC. And I got to say, Mac probably, if you've never used a computer before, this is one of the places where the Mac would shine, because if you picked up an iBook or if you picked up the all-in-one, the iMac. How soon we forget, right? The one that's disappearing. You pick up an iMac or an iBook, it's got great software for iPhoto. It's got great iMovie video editing software in there. It's easy to learn. There's pretty good instructions. A little bit extra software, you can do just about anything on that platform, okay?
Mm-hmm.
For a little less, not much less money, especially if you buy the entry-level iMac, you can get an entry-level PC. Windows XP, the software that comes free with it is not as nice as the software that comes with the Macintosh and OS X with the iMac. But it's still a lot easier. Did I just hear a gagging noise from back here? somebody really doesn't like the XP operating system. But there's still a lot of easy stuff. It's about as easy as it's going to get. But Steve's got it totally right. What you want to do is you need time. And if you got somebody who can help walk you through it and make it a little easier for you, explain stuff as you go along, yeah, you can learn.
Well, about 20 years ago, I thought like heck to get I was not going to go away from my slide rule. And when I finally learned how to use a pocket calculator,
Well, we wish you luck, but now, are you ready for the question?
I hope.
All right.
Okay, here it is.
Who did we talk to, or who do these guys talk to by satellite at the very beginning of the show?
Leo Laporte.
All right. Congratulations, Barbie. I got some good news for you.
I can't believe it.
You got a computer. How do you feel about that?
I've been sitting here a little while and told my wife, I said, I feel like I'm sitting here waiting for the California lottery.
Well, you've won.
Oh, geez, that's wonderful.
So, you mentioned your slide rule and your pocket calculator earlier. Do you have a computer right now?
We have a little laptop that someone basically gave to us.
Okay.
Yeah.
Hey, what do you plan to do with your new computer?
Well, first I'm going to, I don't know, see what it does and learn how to run it, I guess. I'll try to.
Send you an email.
Good.
All right.
That'd be great. Where are you at?
In Soledad.
All right.
Is that what you said?
Yeah, you are in California.
Yeah, it's just below Salinas.
Oh, okay. So it's probably still hotter than heck out there, isn't it?
Actually, no, it's kind of cool.
Really?
Yeah.
Excellent.
It's been cloudy all day.
I hope they have the internet in your city.
He's pulling your leg, Marvin. Congratulations, man. And thanks to everybody who entered and made this one of our biggest giveaways yet. Good for Marvin. You think he's going to, what do you think? Is he going to fire it up? Can he call you guys for help?
What do you mean? Yeah.
Sure.
We should say,
call you guys on the show, too.
Call the screensavers. They'll give you our phone number.
Actually, call for help probably a good place to start, too. So, coming up next, what are we going to do? Is it time to find out
poll results?
Very
yes.
Own Megan.
Do you remember the question was, what was the question? Has the computer industry become more exciting? Was it more exciting than it was 10 years ago? 78% say yes, and 22% say no. And if you have something specific to say about this, you can also go to thescreensavers.com and post in the talkback section of why you think. Because I think this is interesting, because I think we have a lot of people out there watching. They're either, they've been around 15, 20 years, or they're really young and got some different views there. And while you're at thescreensavers.com, be sure to download our new wallpaper. And this just in, you can download our new opening, where we run the credits at the beginning with Pat and Leo in the car, especially the part I like with Leo can't really get out of the car. It's funny. Don't tell him I said that, okay? Stay put. Kevin, Steve, and Pat will read your emails when we come back.
This is Avery and Ben from Glendale, Arizona, and you're watching
TechTV. Be sure to catch Monday's show.
Yeah, find out what Tech Toys comedian George Lopez keeps in his trailer. Plus,
how can you live
a solar-powered lifestyle? And steps to setting up an instant firewall on your PC. That's all on Monday's show.
Well, Windows XP has an instant firewall.
Well, actually, I should correct that. We're going to set up a free and open source. It's called Smoothwall. We're going to set up an open source firewall. It's a combination. Basically, it sets up as a firewall, a proxy server, basically in caches and internet server on an old 486 or a Pentium class PC.
Okay.
It's not on your PC, it's like on your home network. So it's what's really slick is for nothing, if you download the free version of it, you can actually connect it through a USB cable modem, a modem, or over an Ethernet connection to a cable modem or DSL modem. So it's pretty fun.
That sounds pretty cool.
Yeah.
Want to tune into that show. That's on Monday. Yeah,
it'd
be awesome.
So it should be good. You guys got questions?
This is an interesting one from Witchblade, age 32. I'd love to learn how to hack a computer.
Yancey Butler fans.
But not like they teach it in, but they don't teach it in public college. Where can I learn?
You know,
I don't know if I should be instructing people how to hack computers on the screensavers.
The rule of thumb is if you can't figure out how to learn how to hack, especially in the age of the internet where all the tools are openly available and searchable on any major search engine, you probably don't deserve to learn how to hack. Yes. Hint, hint. Failing that, go to Amazon.com or perhaps your local bookseller and see if they have any books on hacking, because shockingly enough, there are entire 600-page tomes on how to hack. If you can't find any of those because you have a more responsible bookseller, look at the books that teach you how to defend from hackers and then pretend you're not the defender of the servers, but you're the person who wants to hack into the servers. Hint, hint.
So don't get caught.
it's all about, look, hacking's been so, the whole concept has been so abused in the past few years. Hacking is about being curious and exploring and trying to find out new and exciting stuff. Go explore. Go search. And I'll tell you what, if you go to Google and do a search on learn to hack, you're not going to get a lot of useful stuff.
There is a good website, www.packetstormsecurity.com has a lot of different tools and tutorials and stuff like that from what I understand. And that might be... Notice the qualification from what I understand, and that might be a resource.
From what people have told you. Yeah.
From what people have told me, yes.
You know, or actually go to DEF CON and defcon.org and read all of the collected notes from all of the seminars that are put out at each of these conventions. Lots of stuff out there. You just need to be a little creative in finding it.
Yes.
Sorry.
Yeah, and if you're afraid of all the hackers and you're not too well protected, get a Macintosh.
Do we have time for another...
I think we do.
Well, let's see. Here's
what
a question.
What do you like, Steve?
Okay. Here's a bunch of questions for me. Okay. What does he feel is his greatest accomplishment in life? I'd say starting the first dial-a-joke in the Bay Area back before you could even own an answering machine or a phone. You could only rent from the one phone company, which was a monopoly back then. And same question for you.
Your best tech account.
What's the best thing that happened to you in my life so far? Meeting Darcy.
Darcy. Oh, man. I think that's it for this edition of the Screensavers. I'm Patrick Norton.
And I'm Kevin Mitnick. Thanks for joining us.
And I'm Steve Wozniak. And we'd like to thank our guests, Adrian Lamo, Adam Sessler, and Tom Hanks.
Good luck in future endeavors. Head down south. Good night, everybody, and thanks for watching. Gentlemen, thank you very much.
Good stuff.